All right. If you have only partial information about your neighbors, that will do for the moment. But before coming out to you, requesting you to speak for 30 seconds, obviously we'll do it on a sample basis. People like the idea of knowing each other more than doing something useful in the class. So I hope you have made at least small notes on a piece of paper. Whenever, if you are picked up in the random sampling and you have to come here and introduce a member of the group, you should be able to do that. You can carry a piece of paper with you if you want to. But right now, we'll stop this discussion and go over to the next matter. So I'll come back to the introductions later. Okay, as I mentioned, each one will have to give a talk for 5 minutes. All talks will be completed on Saturday in two classrooms, 201 and 202. There'll be a 3.5 hour morning session and 3.5 hour afternoon session. However, every person will have to be present only during the presentation of all members of the group. So the number of students in a group, they vary between 9 and 17, for example. So some groups have to spend a bit longer, but the complete detailed schedule will be put up. The schedule will be followed absolutely in a military style. That means if the session has to begin, let us say at 10:20, then it will not begin at 10:21. It will begin at 10:20. Obviously, we will provide some buffer time for people to move out of the classroom and the new set of people to come in. Please note that the 5-minute talk is an upper limit. You can finish your talk in 3 minutes or 4 minutes if you so wish. However, you will not take a single second beyond 5 minutes. Not a single second. So 5 minutes, at the end of 5 minutes, if you are midway through a sentence, you dead stop there at the half sentence, period. Do you appreciate this? You may never have done that. That you are always permitted to at least complete the sentence. I'll tell you an anecdote that happened in a conference in Zurich, VLDB conference, an invited paper, and the presenter was a great known researcher. He had several slides. A German professor was in the chair. At the appointed time, the person started presenting. As the chairman had announced, 10 minutes before the talk, he gave a bell. The person was supposed to speak at most for 5 more minutes. Remaining 5 minutes were for question answers. He continued to speak beyond 5 minutes. At the end of 10 minutes, which was the end of the entire session, the chairman simply said, "Thank you, Professor. The next speaker is so-and-so." Now, this professor, well-renowned researcher, presenting an invited paper, was obviously offended. He said, "Chairman, sir, I have just a few more slides left." And this German chairman smiles, says, "You did not hear me, Professor. I said, thank you very much." And the next speaker is so-and-so. Now that is the respect that one has to give for schedule. For others, not for yourself, but for others. Is that okay? 5 minutes, by the way, is a lot of time. If you think about it, you can actually speak on a topic in 3 minutes or 4 minutes. There is an additional requirement. So no slides. Because slides means transition time is costly. No slides. You can use whiteboard. There will be whiteboard and black markers, etc. There will be a transition time of exactly 1 minute provided, in which the person walking out will have to clean the board. So you get 60 seconds to clean whatever you have written on the board, and then you go to your next seat, your seat. Somebody else comes up. We are organizing such that there will be enough microphones, that the next person is actually ready with the technology. A person can simply walk in and start talking. I won't be there, unfortunately. I'm in a faraway place called Agartala, but our TAs and other colleagues will be there. You have to submit a text file containing the name of the topic. So it should not be a PDF file. It should be a .txt file prepared using a notepad or any equivalent. Why text file? Because the text file can be automatically analyzed. Okay. I will be showing a sample of such a text file now, But the exact format in which you have to write your text file and the naming convention for the file will be informed on the Moodle today. This has to be submitted by tomorrow midnight. None of us are going to read that. But if the text file does not exist on the Moodle, you miss the chance to speak. Simple. And it must exist before 12 midnight. So please don't try to upload it at 11:55 and then say, oh, some problem happened with Moodle. Preferable to leave about 2-3 hours. Best bet is you mull over it. It won't take more than 10 minutes to write that page, but upload it as early as possible. In addition to making this presentation, you also have to assess others in the group who make the presentation. It's a very useful practice to assess oneself. How do you assess oneself? This is an opportunity. Your 5 minutes presentation will be video recorded. It's a short presentation, but you will be able to see that presentation. You will be able to observe yourself. You will be able to listen to yourself. You will be able to see your own body language. You will be able to see how your coverage impacts the audience when you hear it yourself later. So all these recordings will be rendered and will be made available on the Moodle for all of you to see, so that you can learn not only from yourself but from others. And as I mentioned, at the end of the course, we shall have a more formal presentation recorded. And if you do not find improvement in your own speaking abilities, then as I said, I should deserve a fail grade for not running the course properly. All right. Here is a sample. So you have to write your roll number. Obviously, this is a fictitious roll number. This actually is not completely fictitious. I mean, this was the year when I joined the master's program here. So 69 is real. The rest of it is concocted, because those days we had only 6-digit roll numbers. So I've created a roll number to in tune with our groups and so on. So this Mr. Brijlal Chesumal Karamchandani wants to speak on learner autonomy. So he gives the points. IIT Bombay offers complete freedom to a student. These are the points that he has listed. All amenities are provided. Ethos full of energy. Always someone in the lounge. So let me tell you a bit of a history about this student. His real name was one Mr. Pandey. But throughout the first semester, he spent time mostly playing either bridge or chess or carom. He was never seen in the academic area. He was seen in the lounge perpetually. And he was thrilled to find that there is always somebody in the lounge. So that is why he was actually named Brijlal Chesmal Karamchandani. But this is the modified name that I have given. His only problem was the academics was too strict. Some teachers insisted on attendance, which he did not like. And the M.Tech program, Senate insisted on throwing out students if they do not have adequate, in modern terms, if you do not have adequate CPI, you get thrown out. So just to tell you the reality of those days, there were no grades then. There were absolute marks. Each paper was 100 marks. 20 marks, 20 marks were for two tests. And 60 marks were for the NSEM. In the internal two tests, if you scored less than 30% in any subject, you would be thrown out. You won't be able to appear for the final exam. If you score 30% somehow or more, 33%, whatever, then you are permitted to take the NSEM. But if you fail to get 50 marks out of total 100 in two subjects out of six that you are studying, you are thrown out again. If you fail in one subject, you are permitted a special re-exam of 100 marks. If you fail in that, you are again thrown out. The general rule was you are thrown out, occasionally you are retained. Now that was the problem of my friend. So that is why you will notice that while he starts with learner's autonomy, this is the kind of autonomy he has in mind. Why I have created this example is to illustrate that the name of the topic does not necessarily indicate completely the intention of what material the speaker wishes to cover. The actual points to be covered will be completely dependent upon that person's own context. It will not necessarily be relevant to the context that you might create in your mind from what the title explains. But in this particular case, you have complete freedom. You decide on a topic. You decide on the points. But you have to submit such a text file in some appropriate format with a file name convention strictly followed. The purpose is obviously that all these files can be automatically categorized and the content of the file can be automatically assessed or further categorized using a simple thing like awk, for example. So if your text lines are appropriately formatted. Is that okay? Now, there was one student who had a problem on the schedule on Saturday. Is that person here? Yeah. So he had come to me and I had said that we will schedule his recording on either Friday evening or Monday sometime. Are there any other students who have an emergency outage on Saturday? Ah, 1, 2, 3. My God, more and more people are coming up. Okay, can you share the emergency that you have? Did not have emergency at the beginning of this dialogue.
There is a hackathon on Saturday, 12 p.m. It starts at 12 p.m. here itself in IIT Bombay.
How many people? What is your group? 6, 8. So if your recording is over before that, much before that, it is okay, right? You see, you're not required to be present throughout Saturday. You are required to be present for 1.5 hours. So I suppose that is okay then, except for him who has to go out. So as I suggested, please send a mail to me. He has already sent. We'll excuse you and we'll have to decide on a specific time where we can conduct your recording. It cannot be done 10 days later. It should preferably be done on Friday evening itself, or it can be done on Monday morning. But such people who want to be excused from this engagement still have to make submission of their topic and the points that you want to make. And in case for such people, the recording session is going to be organized on Friday evening, then your time slot for uploading the text file will not be Friday midnight, it will be Friday noon. Is that okay? Fine. As of now, there are 2 people who are not free on the entire Saturday. 1 or 2 people who have some engagements. If your slot, because the timetable at that time, when we formulate the time slots, we may not remember exactly this. In case your group comes at that time slot, then you can see, you can actually speak at the beginning and you will have freedom to go away without assessing others. Or you may be permitted to join some other group. My TAs will take a call on that, for exception. All right? Now we come back to the brief introduction, 30-second introduction. I'll randomly pick up someone who should stand up at the place and introduce the neighbor.
His name is Siddharth. He is from Lucknow. He has just joined the PhD program. I haven't had much time talking to him, but I assume he likes playing cricket.
I'm going to introduce Jayesh. He's my classmate and he's from Maharashtra. He did his B.Tech in Mumbai. His interests, he likes music and then he's good programmer too.
You wish to get all your programming assignments done by him or what? As long as you are not caught, everything is allowed. They're heavily discussing amongst themselves. So already you know everything. So I will ask.
His name is Guru Kanwal Singh and he's from Chandigarh. And his areas of interest are wireless networks, cryptography and kernel programming. And he does not have any girlfriends. He plays badminton.
Because you don't have any girlfriends, is that the main motivation to register for this course? No, not necessarily. One of the motivations.
I'll be introducing Ajita Shikhat. She's my classmate as well as my floor mate. She has done her engineering from Government Engineering College, Bharatpur, and she hails from Bharatpur, Rajasthan. She's done her primary education from Dausa, and then she did her class 5 onwards from Bharatpur. That's when she's shifted to Bharatpur. Her hobbies are sleeping, listening to music, and traveling.
I like people have a hobby of sleeping. I love sleeping too, but unfortunately I don't get time to sleep. Let's go behind. The backbenchers are sitting quietly. So let me capture some backbenchers here.
I'm going to introduce Diptesh. He's a first year PhD student here. He just joined our institute in this SEM. He is originally from UP. He did his master's from UP Technological University, and I hope to connect with him very well.
I would like to just mention that as you go ahead and mingle with your group members, try to find out some more specifics. For example, he introduced the friend as coming from UP. If you can picturize the map of India and the map of UP, it's rather a large place, isn't it? With how many crore people? Nobody knows the population of Uttar Pradesh. You come from UP, what is the population of UP? Close to 20 crores. So our friend, while introducing him, has generalized him to be a part of 20 crore people. Had he said, for example, that the person is from Allahabad or from Banaras or from Meerut, it would have pinpointed to a location more closely. The second thing he mentioned is he studied his BTEC in Uttar Pradesh Technical University. It had more than 800 colleges under it. So it again does not tell you anything more specific about the person. I'm pointing this out that we often are satisfied with the generalities, whereas when it comes to people, knowing people, it is useful to know as many particular details as possible so that both of you can relate to each other in a better fashion. All right. So I already consumed much of the time for today's session. Just to conclude, all of you have to make a 5-minute presentation and record it and then assess others who make that presentation. The assessment format, you don't have to write essays, by the way. I mean, if the person is speaking for 5 minutes, you would like to listen to that person for 5 minutes. So the assessment cannot take more than 30 seconds after the person has finished talking. And there will be specific parameters listed. They will be put up on the Moodle so that you can see what those parameters are. And you will have to actually just tick. You don't have to write anything. But that means everybody has to have a working fountain pen or a ink pen or a ball pen or a pencil at least. Jara pen dena aisa nahi bolne ka udhar. You should have your own. All right. So with this, let me ask you whether you have been able to see the video that was uploaded yesterday. All of you, anybody who did not have time to see, can you raise your hands? This is an amazing class. The whole class comes in time. The whole class watches videos. Is there something wrong with you? Very good. I'm very proud of you. In fact, I have told all my colleagues in a faculty meeting yesterday, and I'll be informing the dean and the director of this extraordinary coherence in this class. Keep it that way. If you can sustain it throughout the semester, we'll have a treat for all of you. On second thoughts, I will seek my wife's permission to spend that kind of money. But in the past, she has been permitting me, so that's not a problem. All right. So if you have seen that, proof editing is an absolutely important step. In the days when you construct your documents online, you'll be using some word processing software or the other. Now, how many of you routinely look back at a document to check errors? Can you raise your hands? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, many. Okay. But online, you cannot mark the errors. You can at most correct those errors as you notice them. Or you have to note down those errors somewhere else and then correct. Right? You cannot mark those errors normally. However, the corrections can be marked by keeping what we call tracking on. So that whenever you edit, you cut out something, you insert something, that tracking will be shown. The tracker will show what modifications you have done. How many of you routinely keep the tracking on while editing a document? That's a harder question. Most of us don't do that. Even if we are using a word processor, we depend upon the word processor's inbuilt dictionary to suggest grammatical errors and spelling errors. And wherever there is a red underline somewhere, we quickly go and correct that. So in effect, we are dependent completely on the word processor software to point out our errors and the word processor itself to correct our errors, because it indicates what is the correct spelling and so on. English is a bit of a funny language. Any language, in fact, has its own idiosyncrasies. But English, for example, is spelt differently in in England and in United States. Indian English follows the British English rather than the American English. And if you don't have the right dictionary, you will get a whole lot of horrible errors which appear okay to you, audio. So you have to decide on what standard thing that you will follow. English is also funny because there are several similar sounding words which have completely different meaning. And sadly, a wrong word might be right as far as grammar is concerned and spelling is concerned. So the word processor will never be able to point out that mistake. You agree? I had the occasion of doing this in one of my own promotion interviews. I had prepared a 2-page write-up and gave it to the selection committee members. And I was sitting in front. And the great Professor Mahabala of IIT Madras, who was a member, he was looking at it. And at a certain point, he suddenly said, "Kick," and showed it to his neighbor, who is Professor Hari Sastrabhute from Pune. And I suddenly realized what was the mistake. I had said in one sentence, in my career, something, something, except the career was spelled as carrier, you know, bicycle carrier. And the word professor had said is perfectly correct English. So notice the importance of identifying, locating the error and marking the error. Traditionally, when people had handwritten manuscripts, and which the printer set on a printing machine, sort of, the first rushes, they would be given to you. And then you will have to proof edit them or proofread them. So the small discussion that I presented on behalf of Professor Prakash Vaidya is related to that. We have decided that we will now work on pieces of software which will permit you to do such marking even on the screen. We already have a software which permits us to do that on PDF files. Professor Supratik introduced it to me many years ago. There is a free version and there is a costly version which I actually purchased. So all my students who submit PDF files as their reports, I can actually use a stylus and do exactly this. I don't do proof editing, but I write my comments. You can use that for proof editing, but you require a device with a stylus because you have to mark something by hand. There are utilities which are available where you can put your own comments on a PDF file. But those comments are usually written in the margins and there is no clear way of indicating where exactly that comment relates to. If it is about proof editing, it is not easy. All of you are computer science professionals. I would request you to start thinking about it. What kind of tools could be used to help you proof editing? I'm not talking about correct. I'm not talking about word processing. Proof editing. Like what was it? That means you should be able to mark online the mistakes that you locate. Obviously, the whole process is an iterative process. You have been introduced to some symbols, which Professor Prakash Vaidya will start discussing today. And he will have several sessions following this. But what is important is that these symbols have become standardized over, what, more than 100 years. Chicago Manual of Style, which probably is the first glossary of all these symbols, is almost 100 years old. Now, some of the symbols have lost luster because they may not be any more valid since you don't do printing press kind of thing. But many are still valid. And some simple ones are absolutely mandatory for each one of us to know. So that is what this whole session is about, use of proof editing, and then subsequently we'll also discuss use of punctuation marks and other things. Since we are going to follow the flipped classroom concept, henceforth most of the assignments that you will have to submit will have to be done here and submitted here. There won't be any home assignment. The whole purpose is you discuss among yourselves, work out, prepare something and then make a submission. Many of these will be group submissions. So we will follow a methodology which is called a think, pair, share methodology. Are you aware of this? You have heard of this? No. In a think, pair, share methodology, the class obviously has no lectures. Okay, there are discussion sessions. just like I went around asking somebody to talk, etc., we'll have such occasions. But more importantly, if a point is discussed and a problem is posed, all members of a group attempt to solve that problem on individually on their own. But after every individual has done it, we ask them to share their paper with their neighbor. So I have done this. What have you done? Believe me, there is a lot of learning to find out from what my neighbor has done. Even if that neighbor has made many mistakes, when you explain those mistakes to your neighbor and convince the neighbor that these are wrong, and when your neighbor does the same thing, obviously there is more activity of the mind and learning is better. In simple terms, it's called think, pair, and share. This will be the, so we are saying think, not pair, but group pair and share. The idea is that we do not want to lose focus on every individual, because at the end of the day, each one of us has to become a better communicator. But we will take advantage of the fact that we have so many neighbors and friends, and their collective wisdom can be made available to me individually when I do this. We will follow this mechanism in most of our activity. All right.
Thank you, Professor Phatak.
One was the theoretical part about proofreading. Second was the actual symbols used. Then we had one page giving you a para in three formats. That is the uncorrected form, the corrected form. Corrected means proofread form with markings. And third was including those corrections. If you see on top, this was actually from last year's batch. In last year's batch, we had assignments that everybody had to listen to one TED talk of their choice. And then, so it is listening skills. Then they had to write a short report on that. So this was one of the reports. We wanted to select something which had sufficient errors, and we didn't have a problem. In fact, there were many contenders. We had to choose amongst them. Even the best report, which was only one para, had at least 5 errors. And this one has many more, you can see. The fourth paragraph, so if you see here, you can see the proofread version, in which half the errors are those of commas. That is, you have this with comma underneath. And this is the general pattern that in any document, you will find that half the errors are of those of commas. Almost nobody knows how to use commas correctly. So we are going to have a special session for punctuation marks, mainly commas. The other punctuation marks are not very important. For that also, we have a chart made which we will be uploading, which you can study beforehand, which gives examples. And then in the class, we'll be doing only an exercise. So this shows you what happens. Now, for example, Professor Hawking's words. So in that, P has to be capitalized because he is a specific professor. If it is general professor, you need not capitalize. And Hawking is a proper noun. So H has to be capital. All these things we have actually learnt in school, capitalization rules. But while typing, we tend to forget them. Then Big Bang. Big Bang is the Big Bang. It's not any Big Bang in the second last line. So both B's are capitalized, which you must have read. The word universe previously used to be capitalized. But the present convention is that it need not be capitalized. Previously, English had a lot of capitals, but they are slowly vanishing. And if you have read Times of India, they tried to make even the I, that is first personal pronoun, also small, which is not permitted in English. So the third part, this is the second para of the same submission. We had just blanked out the corrections because we had a PDF file and given you as an exercise. So how many errors could you find in the exercise? Anybody remembers? No, how many? Number of errors, not the individual errors. 10. Anybody else remembers how many errors you? Anyway, you are close to the actual because there were 13 errors in that. Now our next assignment, which we'll be taking up next time, will be a one full page class assignment. And that page you will get 15 or 20 minutes to correct that page. Then we'll just take a poll of how many errors you have found. Then we'll display the model solution explaining each error. And since you have the sheet in front of you, you can check that how the error is marked and why the error is there, etc. So that will give an idea of where we stand and how much we have to improve.
We actually cut it, but it has to be replaced by something. The replacement is written in the margin.
Is written in the margin.
That is the convention.
Yeah. Now, if you have read the theory part, the draft also always has to be double spaced. So, if it is double spaced, you mark it there itself, and you also mark it in the margin, so that you can count and check it.
There are no more conventions, the same convention, but the application of the convention, as he says, is that ideally if you have a double space printout, then you can mark the correction either above or below.
Yes.
But you are expected to also mark it in the margin.
Margin.
To the nearest point of that error.
Yes.
Means the left purpose right. Is you can count. See, this counting error is something which is considered a silly thing. It is not a silly thing. The number 10 and the number 13, you have to reach as many errors as you can find. And this number then reminds you whether you have corrected all 13 or not. Because usually the correction appears in a modified document. And online it is more difficult. Because once you modify, the original version is gone. Unless you are versioning the document. Please understand that writing edited English correctly is actually mandatory in all professional communication. And the developed world always scoffs at us Indians that we are not careful about how we write. So Asian people generally have this problem, people who have great verbal traditions of knowledge. But the Chinese, Asians, Koreans, when they write in English, there is a problem of this. As I said, many people claim that English is not their mother tongue, therefore they make the mistake. I am 100% sure that if you are writing bad English, they're also writing bad mother. Yeah. Which one?
The second last line. B has been made capital.
Right.
In the last line, the flag is repeating again 2 more times. The third, second and the third letter is the last letter.
Yeah. So the last line, the Big Bang.
B has been made capital when the Big Bang appears for the first time. But what is the
second line?
Yeah.
The last line.
For there was no before, what it says. There was nothing before. That first before has been is in inverted commas. And second before means before the Big Bang.
No, the second one will not be capital. Saying before Big Bang.
No, he is right. It should be capital.
It should be capital.
Yeah. All of them should be capital.
Why should Big Bang be capital? Because it's the Big Bang.
The Big Bang. It's a proper noun. It's a proper noun.
It used to be, I also learned something. Big Bang is a proper noun. I thought, he introduced the subject with a Big Bang. Now, yes. That is not the universe.
That is
Big
not
Bang.
The Big Bang.
That is a different Big Bang.
Yeah, right? This is the Big Bang.
So when I use Big Bang in my general writing, I should not capitalize.
No.
Thank you.
Yes. Okay. So about these symbols, we'll see some important things. Actually, we have edited this list. This is for longer because some of the symbols are not relevant. In operational signs, there is move right, move left, flush right, etc. Now these things are done by word processor nowadays. So, if you do the settings properly or even after composing the document, you can give these as commands. Or centering also you can give a command. But still you have to mark this. If it has not been done, you still need the markings. Then the right hand typographical signs. In that many of them refer to the font. For example, italics and Roman and capitals and small capital. In Indian languages, there is no capital and small. So, we are not really accustomed to this. And we have to learn this by convention. And we have to correct wherever it is applicable. And proof editors, these punctuation marks will be studying separately. Now I'll tell you what are the references which we should use. So there is a low-end reference. Has anybody heard of this book? You have used it in school, etc. So this If you have a copy, it's fine. Otherwise, you get a copy. It costs about 200 rupees. This is an old classic. It was originally written in British times, around 1936. Ren and Martin were principals of some colleges. They have written this book. I have used it in my school days. Firuza's mother has used it in her school days. Firuza has used it in her school days. It's an old classic.
My grandson is using this.
Yeah, you see, yeah. So Ren and Martin, you should acquire and go through. It's an entertaining book of those who have read it, because it has many things. It has about poetry, about quotations, the Latin roots, Greek roots. There is a lot of entertaining material. So if in doubt about anything about grammar, you can refer to this. And at the high end, Chicago Manual of Style. This is a publication of Chicago University Press. So they started it at about the start of last century. It's almost 100 years old. They did it for, since they were themselves having a press, they needed a guidebook about how to proofread and how to publish. So when that was circulated, it became so popular that all others asked them to publish it as a book. So they started publishing, and then depending on language change and technology change, they keep on upgrading it. So when I got it, it was the 12th edition. When we got it here, this is the 16th edition. This is the current edition. So whatever we are telling you over here.
That book cost, Prakash?
This costs about 2000 rupees.
2000 rupees?
Yeah.
Well.
Yeah.
You have to be strong-hearted to spend 2,000 rupees of your scholarship. Not scholarship, PA-ship, sorry.
Now, luckily, we have extracted important things out of that. So, whatever handouts we are giving you contain enough material for you to get along. But all of it is traceable to Chicago Manual of Style. This is written like a law book, that each paragraph has a number, like act number this, clause number this. You can always refer by that clause and everybody will understand. Last thing, just before I close, because we have finished our time, is how we have written the date. Does anybody write date like this? You do? Good. What is different from normal writing of date? Normally we write 07012016. Now from mathematics, most significant digit should come first. So that order is scrambled, because date is the least significant, then is month, then is this. Here, if you read, then from most significant to least significant digits. This is the ISO standard, this is the international standard. It is also the Indian standard.
So, on closing, I will suggest that you might want to use this as a prefix to every file name. Because then, whenever you sort files on just name, you'll automatically get them chronologically sorted.
Yeah, and computer programs are designed to recognize this with hyphens as date. They will automatically treat it as date.
Chicago Manual of Style follows American English and Ren and Martin follows British English. So is there a confusion?
Yeah, but there are very little difference. As far as grammar is concerned, maybe some spellings are different. Anything you, as long as you are consistent, it's fine. Don't mix the styles.
I'll close this session with a similar question that was asked in one of my exams about 3 decades ago. Student was from chemical engineering. I had said that in case of difficulty, make reasonable assumptions and state them with justification. There shall be no dialogue between invigilators and the student. And yet one student raised his hand. So I said, read this. So he said, I have a question about that. And the question was, sir, your definition of reasonableness may be different from my definition of reasonableness. So how do I make reasonable assumptions? And my answer was, you make assumptions as per your definition of reasonableness. I will assess them from my definition of reasonableness. Very unreasonable, right? That's how life is. Carry on. Thank you so much.